So we are fortunate to have a panel of three community members who are working in the field of anti-racism: Sheila McLean, Dr. Verna St. Dennis, and Omaira Issa, and they will speak to the local situation and how what Tim was talking about applies to what we're experiencing here in Saskatoon. And the panelists will introduce themselves, starting with Sheila. Sheila McLean.
Hi. My name is Sheila McLean, and I was born and raised here in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. I would like to just say that I am white like Tim, as you can see. And as part of the dominant group, I've been asking questions for a really long time about what kinds of things are happening in our community, particularly as an educator. I've worked in the high school system and the university teaching for a really long time, and have been working in anti-racism for about 7 years now. And I think I wanted to make a few points about this context and watching how all of the things that Tim talked about tonight play out in a space like this. The problem is not that we notice skin color, but the problem is the value that we attach to skin color and ethnicity in our communities. Here in Saskatchewan and across Canada, being white counts for a lot. As white Canadians, it's important for us to talk about how the idea of race works to mark certain groups that have been oppressed historically as inferior, but it also marks the dominant white group as superior. And that's something that doesn't get spoken about very often. It's something that we don't talk about in our institutions, in our classrooms, or in our homes. Now, none of us in this room necessarily created this system of power. But we do have a responsibility to talk about it and try to make visible all of the invisible ways that racism plays out in our lives every day. Racism is a problem that I think is really difficult to address in a Canadian context. Canada has always had this reputation of being a country of equality and freedom. I often give my students, both high school and university, essays at the beginning of the year where they can talk about the Canadian identity or what it means to be Canadian. Overwhelmingly, they talk about Canada being a welcoming country, a safe space, a multicultural country, that worldwide, you know, we have a reputation of being peacekeepers. And so it usually takes me approximately 5 months to unpack all of those messages that they've received growing up. And again, almost by osmosis, because the experiences of immigrants and the experiences of Aboriginal people in our communities is not one of multiculturalism, but one of racial oppression. Now, unpacking this as part of the dominant group, as a straight, white, middle-class female, is a lifelong process for me, and it's a lifelong process for all of us. And I think it's important for us to be very humble in the work that we do towards anti-racism. But I think building alliances, creating allies, is the first step in starting to look at all of the issues that we're facing in our communities. There has been an unequal distribution of social, political, and economic power in Canada historically, and it continues today. And these disparities are caused by historical policies and practices in the past that we see continue to play out today in many different ways. But in addition to the outright denial and racism as sort of this taboo subject that we can't talk about, we prefer to talk about diversity or multiculturalism than to actually say the word racism, it's understood also, as Tim said, as something that primarily happened in the past. It's not happening in our communities today, and is also associated with really specific and unique examples. So when I ask my students what they think of when I talk about racism, the first things that they talk about is apartheid in South Africa, slavery in the United States. They all learn about the Nazis in Germany, and never ever do they make the association with people that of color and what happens in our communities here in Saskatoon. And so it's a lot of work, and these are often grade 12 students, these are often university students that have never had an opportunity to talk about the racism that is happening in our own communities. So one of the things that I like that Tim said tonight is that this isn't about blame, but about placing on the table a problem that has too long been designated as something that we shouldn't be talking about in our communities. Anti-racism does explore how whiteness is produced as superiority, and it's not so much about blame, but about accountability and responsibility. How do we start to make and create these spaces that we're already saying we have? We say as Canadians that we believe in equity, and that we want equality in our institutions and in our communities. We say that we have those things already. So I think it's time for us here in Saskatoon and in other communities across Canada to take responsibility that to create those spaces that we already say we're having, that we already believe in. What anti-racism does is it brings attention to an unequal distribution of political, economic, and social power. So one of the things we can do as allies, if you're wondering, sitting in the audience, well, what kinds of things can we do, is to become well-informed, read, watch DVDs, find out what racism is. There's all sorts of information out there. Right, Tim?
Yep.
Tim's books, obviously. And seek out communities that are supportive of talking about anti-racism and building allies with each other in having these conversations, I think is something that's really important. We can work to make visible the inequitable conditions and practices that exist in our society. They are everywhere. And once you start to unpack and shift that lens, you will start to see in your communities, in your institutions, all of the policies and practices that are happening to keep these racial inequities alive, because they're there and they're real. And they're real barriers that we often become completely invisible to us. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming out tonight in big numbers to engage with us in a dialogue about a topic that I believe touches all of us, that is racism and anti-racism. Thank you, Tim, for being with us tonight. You've certainly given us a lot to think about and talk about. Thanks to the organizing committee, I really would like to thank you for putting such a wonderful and important event for us today. Thank you, Elder Danny, as well, for sharing the wisdom and blessings from our Indigenous peoples of this land. Thank you, Alex. And thank you, Sheila and Verna, for sharing your perspectives today with us. My name is Omaira Issa. I'm a community member, and I will speak tonight, forgive me here, Tim, black like me. So let me start by putting everything on the table right now. I got here in Saskatchewan in 2002 from a very small country, French-speaking country in West Africa, called Niger. So I'm what you would call a recent immigrant to Canada. As we know, race has always been, throughout history, an initiator for difficult and often violent relations amongst human beings. I believe the omnipresent urge to differentiate oneself and one's group from another is always prominent among us. The necessary condition, however, I believe for this to happen is to represent one's group as homogeneous in order to facilitate the process of differentiation, what I think Tim has identified as othering. That is to conceive of the other as another homogeneous group that is everything that we are not. This is a very powerful device that is consistently at play in both individualized and institutionalized racism. In fact, we can even say, without going too far with this statement, that it allows racism and is in turn perpetuated by racism. So if you will, it is a vicious circle. Now, while this process of othering doesn't forcibly equal racism, I think it is very important to recognize its implications, which in the case of race relations between, on one side, recent immigrants and the dominant group, and on the other, recent immigrant and indigenous groups, is quite problematic and often conflictual, particularly in the context of multicultural Canada. Now, the question is, where lies the conflict? Where can we locate it? And what does it look like? It lies mainly, I would say, at the confluence of two separate movements or phenomena. The first is what I would call the complex of the mosaic. The second, I would say, is the one-size-fits-all phenomena. By the complex of the mosaic, I mean that all the different ethnic groups are placed one next to the other in what we call this multicultural Canada. In other words, you can go today to the folk fest and see a Chinese dance, eat East Indian food, and visit a mini Irish pub. And of course, today is St. Patrick's Day, so to all my Irish people out there. That is what we mean by multicultural Canada. In fact, what we mean is that Canada will welcome her immigrants and tolerate the diversity of her ethnic groups up to a certain degree. Needless to say that this multiculturalist agenda, and I'm really weighting my words here, it is a multiculturalist agenda, is a mask to hide the hierarchy in the positions of these different groups. As such, I believe it is a myth that ignores the history and reality of racism in Canada. The direct result of this is the other phenomenon that I identified earlier, called one size fit all, I would call. That is, as immigrants attempt to integrate in the Canadian fabric, the coded message that they often receive is to adhere to, simply put, the ways of the dominant group, as represented by whiteness and incarnated by the institutions, within the institutions as well. So multiculturalism means, in this case, welcome to Canada, and you can eat your fufu at home. But we live in a certain way here. This describes the dynamics between immigrant groups and the dominant Anglo-white group. Therefore, it is not surprising at all that in the process of enacting the Canadian dream, we find immigrant groups adopting dominant, normalized prejudices against the First Nations of Canada. Thank you, Verna. As residents of Saskatchewan, we can unfortunately often witness this. It is absolutely not foreign to us, except if we decide not to look at it and to be in denial. This reality, I would argue, is facilitated by the culturalization of multiculturalist agenda, that is to reduce ethnic groups to quote-unquote culture, and to identify them as simply that, including the Aboriginal peoples of Canada. They are, and often the way they are represented and seen by our immigrant groups, just another marginal culture positioned vis-a-vis the central and dominant culture as identified by whiteness. The immigrants see no exception or historical difference of this particular group. And how would that even be possible when the multiculturalism promotes exactly that? Let me be clear in concluding. I'm not suggesting that multiculturalism means racism. But I am saying instead that in the Canadian framework, this myth of multiculturalism reinforces and facilitates the existence of different types of racism, including institutional racism. We, therefore, I believe, ought to be very careful when we speak of multiculturalism in our society and identify ourselves as multicultural. Thank you.
Well, my name is Verna St. Denis, and I am Métis and First Nations, Cree First Nations member of Beardies Okamasis. I'm also a professor of education at the University of Saskatchewan, And for the past 19 years, my teaching responsibilities have included teaching a First Nations and cross-cultural education course, which in 94 became required, and which I've fashioned as an integrated anti-racist education program. After teaching at the graduate level for a number of years and meeting practicing teachers who had very little useful knowledge about what it meant to be anti-racist, or that they should be, I also developed a course at the graduate level. And so tonight, in meeting Tim and listening to Tim, it's very encouraging and validating, you know, to know that we read and write from a similar perspective of doing anti-racist education. I would like to address the many ways in which a critical race analysis is dismissed or discounted and shut down in spite of so much evidence in our schools and the broader society that we indeed need to learn how to talk about racism and learn how to become anti-racist. I agree again with Tim that we have very low standards about what it means to be educated. Over the many years of teaching, I have and still encounter students and colleagues who believe that talking about race makes matters worse, and that discussing anti-racist education makes people feel bad, or that anti-racism is reverse racism, or that talking about racism implies that we are angry, and so that it shuts down the discussion and openness to learning. And this, despite the countless evidence that not talking about race keeps racism firmly intact. The evidence of racism against Aboriginal Indigenous people is all around us. The evidence of the racialized dehumanization of Indigenous people includes so much, you know, the stats, high suicide rates for Indigenous youth who have given up hope, high levels of poverty, inadequate basic needs like housing and clean water for First Nations, high levels of unemployment, high incarceration rates, low educational achievement, the disappearance and brutal rape and murder of Indigenous children and women. These should be regarded as morally unacceptable in Canada. What I tell my students is that when they drive down 20th Street, or when they end up teaching on a First Nations, that what they are witnessing and what we are witnessing is 500 years of racialized violence against Indigenous people. That's not who we are. That's the effects. That's what violence looks like. I believe, as others do who do anti-racist education, that you can't deal with a problem if you don't name it. Because a trouble we can't talk about is a trouble we can't do anything about. And so we need to put anti-racism on the table. It must become a more substantial issue in the training of the next generation of teachers, nurses, lawyers, doctors. Yet I believe that we're not doing enough. We need for anti-racist education to become a more fundamental part of what we do in our graduate education programs, particularly in the College of Education, where we are, like everyone goes through the public school system. So that's the place that we could surely start. So I believe that our interventions must start there. In conclusion, I just want to say that in a recent national study that I had just completed of the knowledge and experiences of Aboriginal teachers in public schools, the sentiment was shared by many of these teachers that racism against Aboriginal people remains acceptable to many Canadians, and we must say that it is not. Thank you.
Thank you to the panel. So if any of you have questions, now's the time to ask. There's, like I said before, the microphones are up there. We do have a few ground rules for the question and answers, and one is that we ask that you keep your questions short so that others can ask questions as well, and that you please ask questions rather than just making a statement or a comment. One question per person, and you can line up at the microphone there. Okay, go ahead. Okay, we can't hear you yet, sorry.
That was really, really good.
Should be a switch on and just turn it on.
Okay, now it's, great. All right, thank you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to ask the first question. In this dominant culture of North America, the white sphere has become a really big body. And it has gained so much momentum and inertia that it's difficult to stop it, it's difficult to change its direction. I'd like your comment on that. And in addition to that, we have the youth everywhere. There's the youth. There was the youth in Egypt, in Tahrir Square, that changed history. We have the youth here too, and Professor Saint Denis alluded to that. And this is what I pose a question, not only to Tim Weiss, but to the panel, but also to the youth, is that in order to achieve what has never been achieved before, you have to do what has never been done before. Your comments, please. Thank you.
Thank you for that. I think your first observation is certainly correct, that the sphere of whiteness and the power of whiteness has this sort of autopilot effect. It's an inertia that is, as you said, it's hard to change the trajectory of it. But I think what makes it difficult to change that trajectory, it's not just the inertia itself, it's that too many people believe one of two things. Number one is that they don't see this ball coming down the hill called whiteness, so to speak, building up all of this steam and all this energy as being the problem that it is. I mean, if you've come to believe that whiteness is normal and normalized and legitimate, you won't question it. You won't see it as a force that needs to be altered in terms of its trajectory. And I think most people have been lulled into that false sense of consciousness and security, including, I should point out, an awful lot of white folks, working and lower class white folks, economically, who are absolutely, although they do receive relatively to people of color certain privileges, are damaged significantly by that system of whiteness. And I've spoken about this in other speeches that you may have seen on YouTube if you spend a lot of time on there. You know, I have a lot of stuff on there where I talk about that. You know, whiteness was created as a concept so as to take really quite poor peasant class Europeans in the colonies of what would become the United States and convince them against all evidence to the contrary that they had more in common with rich landowners than they did enslaved Africans or indigenous people with whom they in fact had far more in common. So, you know, when you've been propagandized for several hundred years to believe that whiteness is property, and indeed it is, in the sense that you can trade on this. I mean, this has commodity value, sadly. You may indeed fall prey to what W.E.B. Du Bois called famously the psychological wage of whiteness, right? Which is this idea that, well, I might not have much, but at least I have more than them. You know, and sadly, that's what we have to overcome. And I don't know any easy way to do that, but I do know that that's the conversation we have to begin having so that those white folks who in the long run are substantially damaged by the very system that benefits them in the short run can begin to see that, you know. And whoever else wants to chime in on that. Yeah.
All right, so just listening to Tim, I thought of something, I mean, maybe not quite related, but when I started in university in 1978-ish, I was interested in trying to understand this environment, the social educational environment that I'd grown up, where I learned and I received countless messages that who I was as an Indigenous person, child, and young woman was less than. And so, so the discussion back then was like dealing with these Aboriginal students or Indian students who had internalized racism. And that became the focus of the interventions. And so it's ironic, so, you know, finding myself teaching in the college 14, 12 years later, and it's like trying to convince the students that racism is a problem in our society. And I'm thinking, okay, we've learned, we've internalized our, quote, inferiority. Like, how did you miss the message? You know, like, how, what context did we learn that you didn't learn? And so, just to try to bring attention to the broader context and to bring attention to the need to address how racial dominance is produced and then becomes invisible.
What I'm trying to highlight is the fact that this ignorance, I mean, actually this denial, really, as you pointed out very beautifully, is not limited simply to the white people. That is not simply, that is not limited to a geographic location, right? And the reality of the matter is that even in Africa, I mean, within people of the same race, there is quite a bit of animosity towards different ethnic groups, right? But a conclusion that I've come to was the fact that, I mean, given this universality of racism, the issue may not even lie in the fact that we are different races, but it may lie in the fact that there is simply a certain group that is more dominant, right? I mean, as you did say, I mean, answering to the first question, there was that property was a key thing in determining who was on top, right? So, I mean, we can really come to say that the issue is an economic one. That people with more money, who happen to be white, actually. I mean, I honestly believe that if, by some chance and in history, that it was actually black people that did have the that were developed technologically to the extent that they could actually complete the endeavors that the white people did, that they would be in the same place as they are now, right?
I appreciate your point. I would say this, frankly, you know, there were several African peoples who were considerably far more technologically advanced than anyone in Europe for a very long time, up until, you know, maybe the 14th or 13th centuries even. And they did not use that technological advantage in the same way, and I'm talking now about global exploitation, as Europe did when it developed the superior technology. So I'm not sure that it would have gone down the same way. But let's, for the sake of argument, indulge your point and say, you know, that yeah, power is the problem, and people, when they have a disproportionate share of it, tend to abuse it. I think that's probably true. I think there's something that's part of human nature, but it's not all of human nature, and there's also part of human nature which is altruistic and cooperative and collaborative. And which of the human natures, because it's all part of it, which of those gets played up and which of those gets played down is very much based on the story that we tell and the narrative that we tell to ourselves and to our children. And I think, although ethnocentrism and othering, right, exist in every culture, when people come into contact with one another as a matter of, you know, probably evolutionary psychology, there is a tendency to create in-group and out-group. I don't think there's any doubt about that. The question, however, is whether or not what we see in the West, and now globalized, but I'm saying created and originated in the West, is as universal as we sometimes think it is. And I would say it's not, because to be perfectly honest, the idea that we would carve up society based on something as transient as skin color, something as irrelevant as skin color or hair texture or a handful of facial features that are controlled by 6 genes out of 30,000 in the human genome. Now, we didn't know that 500 years ago. We know that now. But the fact that we would delineate on the basis of color really doesn't make a lot of sense. If you think about it, right, it would make more sense to create oppression on the basis of speed. Right? Because if you come in contact with the slower people, you don't want them to be in your tribe because you're going to get killed. You got to be fast. So it would make more sense to create oppression based on something like agility or based on something like speed or strength. And maybe in certain societies that's what happened. But in the West, what we did was we created this very clear hierarchy based on the need to tell a story and to retell the story of European cultural and later scientific superiority and supremacy. And in order to do that, you got to do two things. You have to marginalize anyone that doesn't fit within the European frame, and you have to expand the European frame. So Anglos have to actually then make the Irish white for the first time, even though they didn't view them as white in England, and they didn't view them as white in Europe generally. They were viewed, in fact, as black, and they were even called that in many cases. Italians were not seen as part of, Southern Italians in particular, were not seen as part of the European. They were seen as Mediterranean peoples, and they were not white. Jews were not seen as white. But you have to get all those people on the team, you see, because otherwise you're going to be outnumbered. And so then it becomes a game that's meant to keep telling a story. I think in this country we created, and in the West generally, we created a very unique and pernicious form of oppression. Because if you go back and you look at, you know, long ago, what the Greeks said, for instance, about Africans with whom they came in contact. Herodotus wrote about Africans and not just Egyptians. He wrote about Nubians and he wrote about Ethiopians, which is not modern day Ethiopia, but the certain part of Africa, an entire region within Africa at that time, and talked about them in quite glowing terms. Now, of course, the Greeks thought everybody that wasn't Greek was inferior, but not because they were darker, just because they weren't Greek, right? So that's in-group, out-group, but the color thing comes much later, and I just want us to remember that, because as correct as you are, you know, if it weren't for color-based oppression, we'd probably come up with something else, and we'd have to deal with that too. But in the meantime, this thing that we've got going on right now is not something that's just an inevitability. It was created for very specific purposes, and like any house that's constructed, it can be taken apart and needs to be taken apart.
Okay, next question.
My question is for Tim. I'm just curious to know what answer you gave your daughter when she asked you that question. Because,
that always...
just because I think that we get that kind of answer from a different kind of person,
yeah,
with the same kind of thinking going into it. I'm not saying a four-year-old thinking, but, you know.
It's a great question. Somebody always asks it, so I knew it would come up. That's why I deliberately leave it out, because I want to tease you to ask it. So what happened is, see, I've learned a few things as a parent, not many, but a few. Among the things I've learned is, and it's not just with kids, but I've learned it because of my kids. I've learned that actually it's true for anyone you're interacting with around an issue like this. When it's a one-on-one, not when it's like a sermon and I'm up doing my thing, but like one-on-one or a small group, what I've learned is that usually if you ask questions of the person who says or does something that's objectionable or problematic, as opposed to giving sort of didactic lesson answers. In other words, instead of making declarative statements, let me sort of walk you through a process of thinking critically, right? That a couple things will happen. Number one, the person you're interacting with, be it a child or an adult, will more likely not get defensive or angry or hurt at your question, even though you're trying to get them somewhere, but you're doing it sort of passively. And secondly, they're more likely to come to the conclusion and stay there. Once you come to a conclusion on your own, even if I manipulate you to get you there by way of asking certain questions, you feel like you came up with it. See, this works like when my kids aren't brushing their teeth in the morning before school. So if I got two strategies. One, get upstairs and brush your teeth. We're late for school. How often do you think that works? Rarely, right? Until I say it like 5 times. On the other hand, if I say, what are you supposed to be doing right now? Right? Now, my kids go, brushing my teeth. Exactly. Now they think they're brilliant because they answered the question on their own, and they usually will go do it. I totally manipulated them. But all education is manipulation. So in this particular case, it is. It's just a question of whether it's benign or malign. That's it. But so in this case, my child says, that can't be God. God's not black. God's white. And I knew that I could walk her through a series of questions to try to get at this. So I started, well, I started by doing what all parents do when they're stumped, which is you say, why do you say that? And then she did what all children do when you ask them any question. I don't know. So she said, I don't know. I said, okay, fine. So at least she didn't have some intellectual rationale for this. You know, it was just something she said. And I said, well, here's the thing. Let's think about it, Ashton. I said, I said, first of all, what do you think God did? What is your understanding of that? Now, you got to understand, and I know I'm in church, so this is probably not the place to say this. I'm like a militant agnostic, okay? And I know that's a contradiction in terms, because agnostics, by definition, we're not militant about much. We're like, okay with the uncertainty, okay? But I'm just going to, I put on my theistic hat in the moment with my daughter, right? And we'll deal with the whole crisis of faith when she's 13, but we had to deal with color now. So I said, as far as you know, what did God do? And she said, well, God created everything, right? I'm like, okay, so God created people? And she says, yeah. I said, okay, so tell me, where were the first people? Because I knew she knew this. She had learned this in preschool, actually, that year. There'd been a big map on the wall, and it showed a human migration out of Africa. So I knew she knew this. And she thought about it for a second, and then she remembered the map, and she goes, oh, they were in Africa, right? I'm like, okay, cool. So let's review. God makes people. First people are in Africa. Now, next question. What do people from Africa look like? And she goes, well, they're black, right? I'm like, okay, cool. So let's review again. Because see, the thing about kids I also learned is you can go really deep, you just can't stay there long. Like, you have to get in and get out. So clock is ticking. This review cannot take all night. So I said, okay, so God makes people. First people are in Africa. Africans are black. Now, tricky question. In whose image were people created? Now, she's no biblical scholar, so she doesn't have a clue what the answer to that is. But she goes, wait, what? And I said, well, the story goes that God made people in the image of something or someone. What was that? And she goes, the image of God, right? I'm like, okay, cool. So let's go through it one more time. God makes people. First people are in Africa. Africans are black, and they're made in the image of God. So the final question is, what color is God? And she looks around, and her eyes get really big. And she goes, I guess God could be black. And I said, very good, let's watch a movie. And now, understand, I don't think God, again, I'm an agnostic, so I don't know what I'm talking about, but you know, if there be a God, I do not believe that that God is in any way a racialized entity, white, black, or otherwise. So I'm not literally saying, yes, God is black, but I just wanted to debunk this notion of white normativity for God. We did that, and 8 months later, so you think this stuff doesn't stick with them, but you'd be surprised. 8 months later, she comes to me at the breakfast table as she's getting ready for school, and she's got this really screwed up look on her face. Like, she's really thinking heavily about something, and really distressed, and just like, wow, I'm really deep in thought. And I said, what's going on? And she goes, I have a question. I said, yes. She said, do you really think God could be black? And I said, I don't know. What do you think? And she goes, I guess so. And I said, good, have some pancakes. You got to get ready for school. So, you know, that's the thing. Like, I think you can walk people through a process of critical reflection about a lot of things, and not just that, about a lot of things, and using that kind of model for those conversations, rather than just saying really didactically. You know, it's the same thing when people are denying the problem of racism. I tend to ask them, like, how would you know that? Like, you know, if white folks deny it in particular, how would you know if men deny sexism? How would you know? You know, and what do you think the odds are that maybe those people who we're talking about know their life better than you do? Like, is that possible? You know, and usually reasonable people will have to at least stop to think in that moment. So I just, you know, that's sort of one way to do it.
Yeah. This question is for anyone, everyone who wants to answer, but I'm an Aboriginal lawyer, so naturally I work with a lot of white people in my profession. And I recognize a lot of ignorance, a little bit of racism, but mostly ignorance. If I raise the issue of racism, oftentimes I'm met with, I'm not a racist, or that's not my problem, or I don't want to hear about it. However, given the state of Aboriginal people in this country with the justice system, it's my opinion that lawyers, particularly lawyers who are involved in criminal justice, ought to be educated and informed. I don't think necessarily they want to hear it from me. So the question is, how do you educate people who need to be educated about the issues? So if you have any answers, I'd like to hear it.
Well, I think that's one of the points I was trying to make, is the need for, you know, to raise the standards of what we do in education, and to make, I would be happy to see anti-racist education a requirement in law schools, medical schools, schools of social work, colleges of education. But as it is now, it's up to individual faculty whether or not this is something of concern. And so it's not something that is required. It is not part of the canon of what is, it means to be educated. And so I think that doing anti-racist education requires more than a workshop or two, that it requires a sustained program of learning. And that would mean, you know, in a Bachelor of Education degree where you're getting, what, 90 credits to 120 credits, if 3 credits could be devoted to acknowledging the problem of racism in Canada throughout all our professions and institutions, that would be a great day.
I guess the other thing I just wanted to add is that a lot of people are working on the dictionary definition of racism, which is actually a lie. It tries to get us to believe that racism lives in individual acts of bigots and racists, rather than seeing it as a system. It works in our institutions and it works systemically in this country, and there's been 400 years of policies and practices that has institutionalized racist ideologies in all of us. We're all surrounded by it. So to become defensive and say, well, I'm not a racist, doesn't make sense at all when you understand what racism really is. We've all been immersed in it, these ideologies, and we all have to work to start to question them and challenge them. We do have some agency. We do have a choice as to whether we want to champion those racist ideologies or whether we choose to challenge them. And anti-racism is a way to start to challenge those racist ideologies that we've all been raised with.
Okay. We have time for 2 more questions. So for those of you that are still in the line, perhaps after you could come and talk to the panelists who will be kind of walking around and meeting and greeting people.
I consider myself rich. I have 9 children of my own and 9 grandkids, but unfortunately, I'm underprivileged. But I am a strong woman, and I will survive. Tim, this is for you. You're a strong speaker, but I wonder, how did you get to this point where you realized that we are underprivileged?
Well, I mean, the long version of that, which we haven't the time for, but is, you know, my book, White Like Me, goes into a lot of that detail, and I know that's one of the books they have if people want to get the longer story. The short version is, I think it's true for most people who are white and who aspire to be allies and to work in solidarity with peoples of color, is that we have a series of experiences. Some going back to early childhood, we have a series of mentors and teachers. In my case, most of them not formal educators, but community folks in New Orleans, where I went to college, who were incredible at teaching me the things that, frankly, I didn't learn in the academy. Frankly, I didn't learn in any class, really, college, high school, or anything else. But in my case, it also goes back to my family. I mean, I grew up in the American South. I grew up in Tennessee. I've lived in the South all my life. And of course, I realize, like Malcolm X said, anything, you know, south of the Canadian border is the South. And you all might say, extending his logic, that anything south of the North Pole is the South in some ways. But in any event, my mother, you know, made the decision. She wasn't an activist, but she had enough foresight to make a decision when I was quite young to have my first educational experience, my preschool experience, be at an historically black college in Nashville on the other side of town from where we lived, where I was going to be one of only like three white kids in a class of 20. And on the one hand, she did that because she knew that I was going to have an integrated education, something she had never had, and she wanted me to really be prepared to be in settings where I wasn't always the norm, which that was the foresight piece. The other piece was she wanted to piss off her parents. It's not always noble, you know, but the thing about that was really instrumental, I think, and early childhood is so important. It's why I work so hard to try to have these kind of conversations with my kids, is that it meant two things. It meant my peer group was going to be mainly black kids, so that I was, when we got into the regular school system and coming years, and they were being treated differently, if they were being tracked low into more remedial type material, and the white kids, who I didn't know, the white kids, were being tracked high into the more advanced material, I didn't know what was going on. I didn't have a word for that. I was only 5 or 6 or 7 years old, but I knew it was separating me from the people that I had a connection to, right? So it was actually harming me. I was having an impact on my own life because of racism directed at my friends. And it also meant that I was being subordinated to authority of color at an early age, because most of the women that ran that preschool program were black women. And to have a 3-year-old white kid anywhere subordinated to black or brown authority is very rare. In 1971, for sure, but I would say even today. And it meant that, you know, 20 some odd years later, when I was a community organizer in public housing in the city of New Orleans, and I've got black women telling me about their lives and telling me their truth, I'm not going to be the white guy who goes, "Are you sure you're not crazy? Because I think you might be crazy." I'm going to be the white guy who goes back to that sort of early imprinting that my mom was great enough to give to me, so that when I hear that, my assumption is that authority is every bit as valid as any other, or potentially invalid, but no more so than any other. And so I think that was really key in going to New Orleans and being around, seeing what I saw. And then finally, the one other thing I talk about in the book that was sort of a linchpin moment for me was I graduated, like I said, in 1990 from Tulane, and that was the year, and I know this made news all over the world, so I'm sure you knew this, but that was the year that David Duke was running for the United States Senate, and Duke is the United States' foremost overt white supremacist, overt neo-Nazi, former head of the largest Klan group in the United States. And he was running for the U.S. Senate at the time, and then in 91 he would run for governor. He didn't win either of those, and I was involved in the campaigns against him. But what happened was he did get, in spite of losing both times, he got 60% of the white vote in the Senate race, and he got 55% in the governor's race, which is to say that even though everybody in Louisiana knew this man was a Nazi, I mean, and it's not a word I use lightly, like some of my compatriots in the U.S. who throw it around against anybody they don't like. This is a guy who actually is a Nazi. And everyone knew that, and yet 6 out of 10 white people basically were like, "Oh, well, let's vote for him." And I remember sitting after those campaigns and realizing that there was something profoundly distressing, knowing that 6 out of 10 people who sign the census form the same way that I do, as a white person, were willing, you know, I knew they weren't in the Klan themselves. Like, I knew that 6 out of 10 whites are not Nazis, but 6 out of 10 whites were willing to vote for a guy who was. And that said to me as a white person that I had some real work to do, because those are my people. And it wasn't right for me to continue to ask black and brown folk to save us from us, you know, because they went in and saved us. I mean, black folks basically in Louisiana turned out like 90% turnout. They were like, "Okay, you all have lost your mind. We're going to go and stop you." And, you know, and on the one hand, we're very grateful. But on the other hand, black folks shouldn't have to bail out white people. People of color generally shouldn't have to bail out white people. You know, people of color have been bailing out white folks for a long time. Indigenous, you know, Native North Americans taught us how to farm. Mistake, you know. Mexican peoples taught us how to pan for gold. Mistake. you know, you bail us out, you come to our rescue, and every time it turns out badly, you know. And so I thought at that particular moment, it was time for me as a white person to take accountability and responsibility for these people, because, you know, there's not that much separating me from them. I'm not a superior human being. I could have been them and they could have been me. And the only thing that differentiates me from that 60% is, you know, that I had some life experiences that sent me this way and they had some that sent them that way. And it could have been the other way around. So that was the final sort of opening moment, you know.
Okay, so my question is, I was just thinking about like city council and how it's kind of like octuplets and a woman, and I don't think that's representative of Saskatoon people, so I was wondering how you would propose young people or people in general go about voting to get a more diverse city council that is actually representative of people in Saskatoon. Because I'm not going into politics, I think that would just piss me off. So I think I could just start while I'm still in high school and just get people to vote. So not like one seat reserved for First Nations people. That's kind of ironic. But maybe, like, it's not a coincidence that they're all the same. They look the same. And I just want to stop that and like get a more realistic city council so we can really address the issues going on. So yeah, how do you think we can do that?
Somebody local take that.
Okay. Well, I guess this one's for me. I think that's an excellent question, and I think that it's not just our civic government, but our provincial government and our federal government as well. And I think that obviously there have been multiple barriers historically to having Indigenous people involved in politics. I mean, seeing that Aboriginal people were not even given the vote until 1960, which was not that long ago, given the continual segregation with policies such as the Indian Act, residential schools, the reserve system. So that constant segregation, I know our government has used the word assimilation, and certainly there have been some assimilationist policies. But assimilationist policies along with segregation has caused the alienation of Indigenous people within our governments, within our city council, within our provincial government, and with our federal government. And we see those same policies working with women and obviously with immigrants of color as well. Now, how can we change this? Obviously, part of it is educating people, getting people more involved, getting youth to understand the different ideologies of the different parties and what that means. Because oftentimes, as Tim sort of pointed out, middle-class white folk are actually voting against themselves. They're voting for ideologies that they don't understand, like tax cuts, that they don't understand what's actually going to go down and what's going to happen as budgets start to rise and as we start to focus our tax dollars on, instead of social programs that we actually want, like to build communities like healthcare, good education, like communities where they have healthy water, healthy food. These are just basic needs that all of us want. Those tax dollars start to be funneled into other places as the tax cuts come. And so I think it's thinking about, yes, getting obviously more people involved and getting youth knowledgeable about what these ideologies actually mean. But also I think there's a lot of invisible barriers to becoming involved, running for office, that we often don't see. That we kind of think that anyone can run for these parties. But in fact, when you look at what happens, a lot of it requires a lot of time. it requires a lot of money to be able to advertise. And, you know, as Tim was speaking about David Duke, I was thinking about Jim Pankew in our own community and the damage that he did in this community when he was running for mayor. And I believe that he came third, you can correct me if I'm wrong, and was also a member of parliament and used that power to inflict on our communities constant racist literature and ideologies about Indigenous people. And so we've had our own David Duke in this community, and I don't think there was enough done about that. We have hate policies in this country that should have been taken seriously in that case. And I know that there was some investigation into it. I had some friends that were investigating it. But unfortunately, that case, as far as I know, just sort of disappeared out of the media, and nothing was done about that.
As a woman from a minority group who is an activist in this community, I feel that that question speaks personally to me. Clearly, it's very difficult to debunk systems that have long histories and that function on mechanisms that are passive and active at the same time. I think there are two things we can do. The first one, and these two things, I might add before I point them out, have to be functioning at the same time. I think the first one is to empower marginalized groups. And when we say this, clearly, as you've said, Sheila, and as you mentioned, Verna, this happens through education, but not only. And when we say marginalized groups, we're not just talking about ethnic minorities, obviously. We're talking about marginalized group on gender, on sexuality, on economic privilege, that kind of thing. So I think empowering and resistance from the margins is always, always fundamental. And that has to happen at the same time that you have a decentering of the center. That is, the dominant group has to also be self-critical and always questioning, why is it that at the city council we have 8 white middle-class men and maybe one person from an ethnic minority? So I think these two kind of things have to happen at the same time. And all of us are engaged in this. All of us are concerned by this, because when we're talking about civic responsibility, it's also about representation. So like you said, Tim, if we end up in an election where we have an Nazi running and almost getting elected, it's our fault, pretty much. So resistance and at the same time decentering. So both the margins and the center are working at the same time.
So also thank you for that reminder that racism just doesn't exist on its own. There's multiple forms of oppression that are often happening. And I'm going to ask a question, because if I was in the audience, I would have ran up and asked this. There are multiple forms of oppression. What are your thoughts on when people use cultural protocols or spirituality as a way to reinforce misogyny and homophobia?
Who are you asking?
Anyone?
Okay. Do you want to start?
Well, some of you might know that in some of my research and writing that I have I do an analysis and a critique of the way in which cultural discourses are used by both dominant society to reinforce inequality, but I think also how members of our own community can also use those same discourses to justify discrimination against gay and lesbians in our community, or to shut down discussion around misogyny and marginalize feminist analysis of the way in which our own communities have adopted patriarchal traditions in our society, either through the schooling system or through Christianity. And so when I talk about doing integrated anti-racist education, I'm both addressing First Nations, Indigenous communities, as well as non-Native communities. And so that's something that I speak to and speak against, is the use of cultural tradition or cultural practice to justify marginalizing members of our own community.
I just actually want to take a moment before Tim talks to thank my teachers that are both here tonight, Dr. Verna St. Denis, who's been my teacher and friend for the last 7 years, and Dr. Alex Wilson, who has also been my teacher for the last few years. So thank you, both of you.
And I would just add to what was already said that I think the mistake that we make, and dominant group members do it, and marginalized group members do it also when they adopt some of those cultural traditions and norms and assumptions of the dominant group, is when we speak of culture and we talk about, you know, this group's culture does X, Y, and Z, we're almost always making this ridiculous overgeneralization about what is and is not normative for any particular group. So you'll hear the dominant group in this country, for instance, you'll hear white Christians in particular, who will say of cultures other than their own that they have these strange cultural traditions, and some of the things they may be talking about could be truly horrific. I mean, you know, you have a lot of people who rightly are appalled by, you know, female genital mutilation in various parts of the world, but it is a huge mistake to ascribe that practice to an entire culture when there have always been women in those cultures who have resisted on pain of death that practice. And so we end up, you know, it's not that that culture is inherently misogynistic, inherently woman-hating, inherently patriarchal. In fact, much of that of the cultural traditions that we're speaking of, where that practice has emerged and has existed for a period of time, actually have, you know, matriarchal traditions as well, and not merely patriarchal ones. But that's what we see, and then we want to boil it down to culture. And then, of course, there will be some people in the culture itself who will believe that that's who they are, and then they will defend the practice as a cultural tradition, when in fact part of their cultural tradition is also resistance to oppression. That's a cultural tradition. And every cultural tradition includes a tradition of resistance. So I think that the mistake that people make sometimes when they're in the marginalized culture is believing the things about them being said by others, that that's what they are and that's who they are and that's what they do. And, you know, and then the dominant group, of course, can always point to individual examples of those practices that are misogynistic, that are heterosexist or straight supremacist, and act as if somehow that's them, as opposed to that being us. You know, I mean, I had a question at an event not long ago where I was asked about sort of the inherent misogyny and straight supremacy embedded in hip-hop culture. And I thought, well, you know, what is hip-hop culture? It exists. I mean, I know exactly what it is. It's a significant culture, but it's also one that exists within this larger context of a dominant culture that is every bit as misogynistic and straight supremacist. I cannot put on hip-hop artists what I will not put on presidents and what I will not put on congresspersons and senators and lawmakers who have legalized straight supremacy, first of all. It's perfectly legal in the United States, and that have all but legalized misogyny in many ways, despite certain laws that are ostensibly aimed to get at it. So we pick on subcultural units within the larger structure and act as if the things that we don't like about them are somehow unique to them, when in fact they reflect the larger culture that they find themselves in, and are just as prevalent in those dominant cultures. But the dominant culture has the luxury of sort of mystifying all that, you know, and not recognizing the complexity of cultural groups. You know, most people, if you ask them to define what culture is, you'll get 50 different definitions if you have 50 different people in the room. That just lets you know we're not dealing with something really scientific. We're dealing with something that is very subjective, and we just need to be careful when we're dealing with something subjective that we're not overgeneralizing about the other and undergeneralizing about ourselves, or under-applying the same thing, you know, to ourselves.